Welcome to In the Envelope, a podcast from Backstage, the number one resource for actors and talent seekers. I am your host, Jack Smart, awards editor at Backstage, and I'm here to guide you through every aspect of the entertainment industry with the help of some of your favorite stars. These intimate, inspirational conversations with today's most award-worthy film, television, and theater artists provide you, dear listener, advice on how to live the creative life, personal stories of success and failure alike, and maybe, just maybe, a tantalizing glimpse in the envelope.
And actually walking into something with a much more kind of open interpretation, you know, let's just see what happens, is actually quite liberating. I'm finding that more and more, that I work better when I don't overthink and overprepare too much.
Testing 1, 2, 3, testing 1, 2, 3. I hope I sound good. Welcome, listeners, to another episode of In the Envelope. We have an exciting episode for you today. The voice you just heard is Michelle Dockery, an amazing, amazing actor. Look, it kind of goes without saying that all of the actors featured on this podcast are amazing actors. Maybe I don't say it enough. They're all supremely talented and good at what they do and good at talking about what they do. But talking to Michelle, listening back to this interview, visiting some of her work, seeing everything she's done, Michelle Dockery is just a really, really good actor. She's just a good actor. If you are looking for your definition, if you want a definition of great acting, just study what she does. She is amazing in this new show from AppleTV Plus called Defending Jacob, opposite Chris Evans and Jada Martell and friend of the podcast Betty Gabriel and J.K. Simmons. It's a stunning, stunning cast. Michelle, of course, was Lady Mary Crawley. She was the lead in Downton Abbey, but talk about somebody who can be a chameleon and can reinvent herself for every role. So this conversation was a great kind of insight into how she does that. We talked a lot about nerves, preparation versus letting it go. She has some great stuff on voiceover and accent work. If you know anything about Michelle, if you've seen any two of Michelle Dockery's performances, you know she's amazing at accents. And yeah, we should get right to it. Over on backstage.com, we are very much gearing up for Emmy season. The 2020 Emmys are still ongoing, despite everything happening in the world and in our industry. Emmy nominating takes place July 2nd to 13, and nominations will be announced July 28th. I'm so excited. So head over to backstage.com for plenty of content featuring nominees, and stay tuned in this podcast because we are releasing episodes twice a week between now and the end of nominating and probably beyond. So without further ado, I think that's all I have to say for today. Let's get to this excellent interview, this excellent deep dive with Michelle Dockery after a quick break. Today's podcast is brought to you by the Apple TV Plus original series, The Morning Show. This drama series explores the cutthroat world of morning news and the lives of the people who help America wake up in the morning, told through the lens of two complicated women working to navigate the minefield of high-octane jobs while facing crises in both their personal and professional lives. Starring Jennifer Aniston, Reese Witherspoon, Steve Carell, Billy Crudup, Gugu Mbatha-Raw, and Mark Duplass. For your Emmy consideration in all eligible categories, including Outstanding Drama Series, visit fyc.appletvplus.com. Michelle Dockery, although likely best known as Lady Mary Crawley in the hit series and last year's film, Downton Abbey, is an actor who reinvents herself in role after role, from early stage work in her hometown of London to Anna Karenina, Good Behavior, Godless, The Gentleman, and now Defending Jacob from Apple TV+. Michelle has totaled 4 Emmy nominations and 3 SAG Award wins. Here is our deep dive with the phenomenal Michelle Dockery. Michelle, hi.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Good to meet you. Thank you so much for for joining us at Backstage. We love you here at Backstage.
Thanks for having me.
Are you in London?
I am, yeah, at home in London.
And how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. All things considered, yeah, very well, thank you.
Yeah, and are you doing a lot of this virtual press right now?
Yeah, it's quite a different way of doing it. It's less of a circus, which is quite nice. Don't have to, you know, think about what to wear and, you know, all of that. It's actually it's a much more relaxed way of doing it in some ways. But yeah, it's been really interesting.
No red carpet. There were no like events for this project at all. It's really strange. Yeah, it's strange. It's strange times. I mean, are you keeping busy otherwise? Did you have other projects in the works that were put on hold?
I didn't, and I was taking a little bit of time out anyway. Okay. So I've just been at home, which has been nice for me because I'm normally in the States. I travel a lot with work, so it's been a real kind of slowing down time. And I've been cooking a lot and binge watching shows. I'm really into Ozark.
Oh, okay, great.
Which I'm very late to the Ozark hype because, of course, it's in its third season. But I'm absolutely loving it. It's been nice to catch up on things that I hadn't had time for until now.
Yes, you're staying artistically inspired and engaged.
Yes, I am. Yeah, and reading.
However you can.
Reading a lot and, and sometimes just things, you know, films that I hadn't seen in a long time and and reading things that I hadn't had time to do, so I hadn't had time to read. So it's been nice to catch up on all of that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting, the rewatching. I was talking to someone recently about how that's actually, it makes sense that we're rewatching old things that we've already seen or rereading books we've already read because we are bombarded right now with like new information and we're overloaded with new. So we want the comfort of something we know.
Yeah.
And that's true for me. I'm not watching a lot of new stuff.
I watched recently, I did a Harry Potter marathon.
You did? I did too.
I did. I just suddenly woke up one day and decided to, it was just before we started press, or it was sort of in the middle of when, you know, we had a week and it went very quiet. And and I just thought, I'm going to cozy up and watch the Harry Potters. I mean, it's years since I've seen them. And actually, I think one or two of them I hadn't even seen. I hadn't seen, I don't think, the Order of the Phoenix, like the fifth or the sixth one. I'd just forgotten how many brilliant actors are in the Harry Potters. And I just sort of fell in.
Probably
fell back
many
in
of your friends
them.
And colleagues. Maggie
yes,
Smith.
Maggie, Imelda. I mean, everybody pops up.
That's cool.
So that was nice to do something like that. I do like a bit of kind of that sort of fantasy genre. So I haven't yet attempted the Star Wars. I am ashamed to say that I don't think I've ever seen a Star Wars film. I probably did when I was younger. But I am determined to, you know, to get it.
Now's the time.
Yeah.
Now is as good a time as any.
I know.
Yeah, it's strange times. It's good that Defending Jacob was packaged and done and ready to go before all this happened, so that there's something to do.
Yes,
and something for us all to watch. I mean, it's a fun show to watch. Fun.
I think fun in a sort of whodunit kind of way. Yeah. It's a real roller coaster, isn't it? I mean, I think people. I mean, I certainly love a crime drama like this, a whodunit. But what's so great about Defending Jacob is that it becomes more about the family and the way that they deal with, you know, this horrendous situation that they find themselves in. it focuses more on that, which when I first read it, I thought, well, this is really interesting, because normally you're sort of following the detectives more, or you're following the barristers more, or, you know, it really kind of shows the other side of the curtain and how this family deal with it, and how these parents deal with what their son is about to go through. And it's just very compelling to watch. I think every episode's a cliffhanger, isn't it? So
yes,
it's great that it's on weekly. I love this new format, which is the old format, of course, of doing something weekly. And I think it's great. I think we're so used to being able to watch things immediately and binge it, which is, you know, people have the freedom to do. But I think it's really refreshing to be able to watch something weekly and then have those breaks in between, and you get to talk about it and ask other people what they think and who did it, and, you know, it's fun.
Which this is maybe too, we're generally more focused on, this is Backstage, so we're more focused on the acting. I'm gonna pick your brain about craft and career advice, but
go for it.
Do you, just very specific defending Jacob question, do you think he did it? I don't know. I think he might have done it.
I think he might have done it.
Because there is a way to talk about it without spoiling it, because it's not really answered either way.
No. That's what's great about it, is that there is, you know, there's so much sort of ambiguity with the story, you know, at the end. And it's sort of, it's kind of left up to the audience, really, to decide. But I mean, I'm saying that also from my character's perspective as well, because I think Laurie thinks he did it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. But it's a hard one. You know, I don't want to spoil it for people. And I'm looking forward to seeing the last episode again, because it's been a while since I've seen it. Mm. And I will have an opinion when I've watched it again. I think I'm looking forward to seeing it and seeing how I feel afterwards. Now I've had some distance from it.
Yeah. My gosh, is there a thing too in a show like this, especially with like that kind of ambiguous whodunit, where like the editors choose a lot of maybe the truth of the show? Like, do you do, for example, two different takes where one is more Laurie's convinced he did it and one is she's less convinced, and then you see which one they pick?
There was a bit of that on this, in particularly in those moments, you know, you don't want to give away too much. You also don't, you want to give an idea of what a character is thinking and feeling. So there were moments where Morton and Mark, our brilliant writer and director, would just guide us. Because sometimes I often think as I'm, you know, on this journey, I'm learning more and more that you can be quite subtle and it reads very, very boldly sometimes on camera. So with something like this, I found that could be a challenge at times, because of course you want to be as subtle as possible, but even more so because, you know, the whole courtroom scenes are about, you know, not showing any emotion, and, you know, everything's kind of hidden. And Laurie is a character that very much wears her heart on her sleeve. So it was a challenge, actually, the kind of more still moments, you know, without dialogue and not, you know, trying not to show an opinion or reaction was a challenge at times. Yeah.
There's a lot of like restraint, I suppose, in a show like this. Is it the kind of thing where you, it's show, don't tell?
Yeah.
It's like a level of subtlety that's, I don't know.
Yeah.
You don't want to telegraph exactly what the character is thinking, because who can name that anyway,
right? Yeah. And Morton loves those shots of kind of lingering on a character for quite a long time. So as I was playing the part and working with Morton, I guess I sort of got to a point where I knew my limits and subtleties. Cool. And if I went too far, I mean, he's a great director, because Morton, he really encourages you to go quite far and then you can rein it back in.
Gotcha.
Because with Laurie, there were times when we had to sort of measure it, you know, because we didn't want her to be constantly bawling her eyes out. So it was finding a balance, you know, between each scene, the restraint, and then the kind of letting go in the moments where she was alone.
And I imagine the really letting go and then having him rein you in.
Yeah.
I just imagine any very weepy scene or very emotional scene is hard to do multiple takes. Like, how do you reset?
Yeah. I mean, so much of it, I have to, or I've certainly learned as time has gone on, that I have to really reserve that energy. I'm a very sociable person on set. I like chatting to people and finding out what they're, you know, what they did at the weekend and chatting to crew. And on this, I learned quite quickly that I had to really reserve my energy because it was emotional. And I find that I like to do the close-up, you know, often you can be given an option of doing the closer, the tighter shot first, right, which sometimes going into a scene, a new scene that is emotional, that adrenaline is there. Like at the beginning, I often find it's very, very at the surface. So my first take in a tight shot is often the one. And really? Then after that, you're recreating it. So if you have that option, you don't always have the option, of course, because depending on the location and what the, you know, what your DOP and director want to, you know, how they want the shots to play out throughout the scene, it's not always the case, but it is a luxury when you get that to do,
amazing,
you know, to do the most emotional shot first. So we did, there was definitely, you know, that option on this, you know, Morton was so much about, you know, getting that right in the moment and it feeling so real. So he was so understanding of that sort of process.
So you're one of those, you're the one of the first take type of actors.
I mean, not all the time, actually. It's just most of the time it's the first go at it because you're doing it for the first time. So it feels authentic. And then every other take is like you're recreating it. So, I mean, I'm sure that's something that most actors relate to. But then there are scenes that I sometimes build up to. I mean, that scene with Chris and I in the most recent episode where Laurie, after the court, after the story has been told about Jacob's secrets and what he has been up to, that scene between Laurie and Andy, you know, there was definitely a build up to that. Because it was like, it was a long, long scene. It was like doing a play, that scene. Like, it was a long, long two-hander. And sometimes it's like you're just sort of finding your feet with a scene like that in the first few takes. So you do the wide and then you find the movement and the, you know, the sort of structure of the scene. And then you
sort of
really
like
get into it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then it sort of built from there. So by the end, we were, you know, quite emotional by the time we kind of came into the much tighter shots. Because also you also don't want to lose the energy in that. You don't want to give it all away immediately.
Right. You've got to pace yourself. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of that on this because it was emotional. I really had to pace myself.
Yeah, I bet. Well, and you said you called it adrenaline. The adrenaline of the first take. Is that nerves? Does that come from nerves?
Of course. I mean, this job is, I mean, you walk on every day feeling vulnerable. I mean, we're
amazing.
All just holding hands and like, you know, jumping in and seeing what happens. So it's, of course, I mean, even when you're 6 months into a job and you know everybody and you've got a great rapport with everyone, you're all best mates, I still have those nerves before certain scenes, you know, when it requires a real vulnerability. So yeah, nerves do definitely play a part because the nerves make you want to burst into tears.
yes, it helps up the stakes. I think it's really great to hear. I mean, I think our listeners of this podcast, I don't know, I personally think of an actor of your caliber as someone who, you know, you have enough experience to not be nervous, but if the nerves happen every time, then they're part of the, are they part of your artistic process?
I think so. I think it's all part of it. And sometimes I think if I didn't have it, maybe I wouldn't perform quite as well. So I think a little bit of nerves is good. And I think it's partly excitement. It's, you know, feeling vulnerable, but it's also, it's why we do it. We're sort of, you know, we kind of love the sort of suffering for it. I don't know, because maybe it feels very, it's rewarding when you do, get there and you go through that little struggle and then you get the scene and it's great. But it's certainly, it has gotten easier. I mean, I'm much more used to the process now, and I have sort of my own way of working, and, you know, you learn as you go along. So you're not too nervous, or, you know, you find ways of sort of dealing with it.
Is everything you just said, is that the same is true for auditions, or are auditions a separate kind of nerves or a separate process?
Similar thing, really. Like any interview, I think for a job, you know, I think everybody can relate to it. It's, you know, you're walking into a room and people have no idea who you know, they don't know you unless they know you from, you know, something that you've been in, or, but you're walking into a room full of strangers and you're about to be vulnerable in front of them, you know, I mean, depending on the role. So of course it's always, there's always some nerves there, but what I've learned is that, is to leave myself at the door and just play the role, you know, play the role in that audition the best I possibly can and leave everything else at the door, because the part of you that they see in the room as yourself, it's only it's a tiny percentage of who you are as a person. They're only seeing it for 10, you know, 30 minutes maximum, or, you know, however long an audition takes. And so to worry about all of that, like, oh, what did I, you know, when I said that, what they think of me and blah, blah, blah. You know, I used to do that all the time, especially in my 20s. Right. And I'm learning, like, well, they only know a tiny, tiny portion of me in those 30 minutes. So you may as well just throw yourself into the part in those and use that time to show them this is how the part can be played, and, you know, pick me.
Pick me. And sort of that, I love that idea of leaving yourself at the door, because it's separating you from the character, I suppose.
Yeah, a little. I mean, I'm not saying you kind of walk into the, you don't necessarily don't have to walk into the room as the character, but I think leaving those, I certainly try my best to leave those insecurities at the door, you know, of what they might think of me as a person, or, you know, and just to sort of use that time. I remember this audition that I did a chemistry test with Javier, the guy who played Javier in Good Behavior, the show that I did in on TNT, Juan Diego Botto, who is a phenomenal actor.
Yes.
And I never forget his screen test, the chemistry read that we did. So I'd already been cast, and then we were reading Javier's, and he was, you know, you could get a sense of him as a person, but he just stayed in the energy of the character. He wasn't being method or anything, but there was this, I could tell he had gone, I'm going to walk into this room and I'm going to show them what this part this is character. And I'm going to do it, and I'm going to do it the best I can play it, and how I would do it on the day if I was in on set with the cameras and lights and everybody. And it was a real inspiration for me seeing that. And he got the part, because everybody was like, that's, he's just played it as he would play it on the day, which is what they want to see. I never forget that.
That's amazing. Did you, are auditions happening less and less? How did you get involved with Defending Jacob?
Defending Jacob, I was sent the script. So I was sent the first, I think I read the first four. And then they offered me the role, and then I had a Skype, you know, much like what we're doing.
Just like this.
Yeah. Where was Zoom then?
We didn't
Zoom.
It feels like years and years ago.
Yeah.
Not that long ago.
No. So we had a Skype or FaceTime, and I loved Mark and Morton. You know, sometimes when roles come your way, or, you know, something comes along, it's not just about the part, it's about the people. And and I guess in some ways I'm making those decisions more and more lately.
Right.
But I just love them. I thought I was a fan already of Morton's work. Mm-hmm. There's something about those Scandinavian directors as well that just, it's like a sweet spot. I don't know what it is. It's just they have this ability to create this visual tone that, I mean, I think that comes across in Defending Jacob. It's something that they get. I don't know what it is. I just can't put my finger on it. But I loved him and I loved Mark. And I just, you know, he's a brilliant writer. And I just thought, oh, if these two, I'm just having such a lovely chat with them. And they're so passionate about the scripts. And it was like a done deal.
That's interesting that it's maybe more about the collaborators than the character or the project itself. Sometimes.
I mean, I always have to, have some feeling, gut feeling about character, which I certainly did with Laurie. But then there are other elements that come into play also, which is great. Right. And this was a real, you know, it's when it feels like all the dots are joined, and it was a real kind of bullseye, this job.
And building Laurie, like, how, first of all, there is source material. So did you draw from source material? Do you invent backgrounds for some of your characters or all of your characters?
With Laurie, I read the book, but mm-hmm. then, of course, the book, it deflects somewhat from the book, the script. So sometimes that's not always useful. Like, it's good to kind of read it, and then you know that's where it's the source, that's where it came from. And and there are some details that I liked, but for me, it's more about what's on the page and actually what comes out in the moment. I'm learning, and this isn't, for, you know, this isn't, I don't want this to sound like advice or anything, but the way I work now is that I tend not to prepare too much, because in the past I've over-prepared for something and it all goes out the window. And what I've learned from that is that it helps me to not feel, I can kind of lose control, which is good. In the past, I've had a tendency to sort of over-prepare and make assumptions about a scene and the way it should be played. And I think I should be stood here. And of course, there are so many different elements that come into play. Of course, your fellow actors, but, you know, props and locations and actually walking into something with a much more kind of open interpretation, you know, let's just see what happens, is actually quite liberating. I'm finding that more and more, that I work better when I don't kind of overthink and over prepare too much.
The other thing I wanted to ask you about, especially in regards to auditions, because you actually mentioned this idea of early in an actor's career, it really is a job interview where you're introducing them to you and they don't know who you are. But later, it's both a benefit and maybe a curse when they do know you for your work. You've spoken before about how you are nothing like Lady Mary, but is it safe to say that most people know you as Lady Mary?
Yeah.
So do you then, has there been any strategy in your next career moves to get away from Downton Abbey? Or is it just you're taking whatever projects are interested in you? Do you think about type at all?
It's something I very, very quickly after Downton, I was cast in Good Behaviour as Letty, which was worlds away from Lady Mary. Yeah. So I sort of didn't really have time to even worry about it, about having any sort of typecasting. I just suddenly went into this role that was very, very different. And that wasn't strategic, actually. It just happened quite naturally, which was great because it was liberating to do something very, very different. But I don't tend to be strategic with career choices. It really depends on the role, the story, the people. And creators out there do have more imagination than you think, you know. And I love casting directors and, you know, creators for that, because all of us from something like Downton, you know, we've all done very, very different things since. And I think sure. in some ways that's because if I were to be cast in a 1920s drama, yes. I'd have to have a very different haircut or something because it would be like Lady Mary has just walked into yes. another story, you know. So maybe right. it's doing something very, very different, of course, because of what you're known for, that people, you know, it's maybe more risky to kind of cast us in something that's too similar.
And not just for your own personal wanting to be challenged, like it might interrupt or take somebody out of the story if they're watching a 1920s drama and
yeah.
Michelle Dockery walks in looking a bit like Lady Mary. That's a bit like mm-hmm. distracting.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's all about serving the story.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
And is it also safe to say it's for most working actors, it's strategizing is impossible and you don't get your pick of the litter.
You just don't know. Yeah. And I learned that very quickly, is that you don't always have the choice. And it's a career of very, it's unpredictable. And I found that hard at first. I, you know, definitely went through phases in my 20s where I wanted to know more, and I was, you know, mm-hmm. went through phases of kind of feeling like, oh, I really want to do that next. And why isn't that coming my way? And, you know, mm-hmm. and learned very quickly that you don't have any control over it. And sometimes right. parts just come along and you, like Defending Jacob was like that for me. It was just, it sort of mm-hmm. came out of nowhere. I wasn't in, I love crime dramas, but mm-hmm. I wasn't looking for one.
Right.
It just sort of came along, and it was one of the best experiences I've ever had.
Today's podcast is brought to you by the Apple TV Plus original series, The Morning Show. This drama series explores the cutthroat world of morning news and the lives of the people who help America wake up in the morning, told through the lens of two complicated women working to navigate the minefield of high-octane jobs while facing crises in both their personal and professional lives. Starring Jennifer Aniston, Reese Witherspoon, Steve Carell, Billy Crudup, Gugu Mbatha-Raw, and Mark Duplass. For your Emmy consideration in all eligible categories, including Outstanding Drama Series, visit fyc.appletvplus.com.
Has it always been acting for you, just from infancy, from day one?
Pretty much, yeah, from infancy. I've been acting from day one. I was always dancing and singing, you know.
Okay.
I went to a stage school, which mm-hmm. was at the bottom of our street when we were kids. It was right at the end of our street. And it was a hobby. And I loved it. I just fell in love with it. And I loved dancing and singing and acting. And then it very quickly became what I wanted to do. I had a very encouraging drama teacher at school called Jude Burt, who, to this day, I think if it wasn't for her, I'm not sure I'd be doing this. And she really encouraged me. She saw it in me that acting was, you know, something I had potential in. And so, yeah, I never looked back. I think I probably may have gone down the dancing route. I may have done musicals. Because a lot of my friends went off and did musicals after stage school. And so I actually auditioned for some. I auditioned for Joseph, which my sister actually was in.
Oh, okay.
And then she was a dancer. And then there was something else, another musical. And I sometimes think, God, if I actually got them.
That path, yeah.
That my path would have been very different.
Because I always like asking if there were anything else, any other career you would do. I mean, what would that be? Maybe yours is just a different avenue in the acting world. It would have been,
I mean, dancing, probably it would have been dancing. But the thing that I am obsessed with is interiors, interior design.
Oh, okay. And, oh my God, cool.
Yeah, I really.
And then you got to act on a show about a show called Downton Abbey in a giant abbey with the most amazing interior design.
Yeah, it's
that's cool.
It's something I just really enjoy. I moved into my house in London a few years ago, and I've really enjoyed, you know, choosing wallpaper and choosing paint. And I really love it. And I do think if I'd have done something entirely different to being an actor, It probably would have been something like that. I mean, still artistic, you know, but right. design, certainly something right. like that.
So at first it was maybe musical theater and then it was mostly stage. I mean, how has the dream evolved? You were certainly first and foremost
stage.
A theater actor.
Yeah. So I was at the National Theatre for nearly 2 years. That was my first mm-hmm. job, which was incredible because it was like an apprenticeship, actually. I left drama school and then I went straight there. And at one point I was understudying. I was playing like eight parts at the same, or I had roles in my head at one time because I was playing two or three roles. It was His Dark Materials. We did it in two parts, the Philip Pullman trilogy. And it was in two parts and I understudied Lyra, the main character, which was huge. And then I understudied a few other characters because you do that thing. They cast it brilliantly so that if one person steps off, then someone steps in and there's kind of like a knock-on effect. But yeah, I had eight different characters' dialogue in my head at one time. Can't imagine doing that now. I mean, so the National was a big, you know, part of my training, you know, sort of early training into the industry, really. And then I did Pygmalion with Peter Hall, which was that was a big stepping stone when I played Eliza Doolittle, because Gareth Neame, our producer and co-creator of Downton Abbey, he saw me in that production. So that's where that then led to. And it was really in my later 20s that I then got Downton and was doing more TV and film.
Are you open to still doing theatre? Do you separate the two mediums, stage and screen, or is it all?
They are very different. They're very, very different. A couple of years ago, I did a network at the National with Bryan Cranston, which was a brilliant experience, but it was nerve-wracking because it had been 8 years since I'd been on stage. So, and it's very different. And I sort of had to kind of re-oil those joints in a way. Because it just felt very, very different to being on camera. It's a different way of acting. I would love to do it again. I would love to go back on stage again. But I think that now I used to feel more comfortable on stage and now that's changed. I definitely feel more comfortable on camera now. So
interesting.
Yeah, which is why I need to do a play every few years, because I never want to get to that stage where I'm too afraid to go back on.
It's all about challenging yourself, and I guess it's always, you can't keep all of the wheels oiled all the time. It's all about re-oiling the wheels.
Yeah, absolutely.
For each project.
Yeah.
Because you mentioned too this idea of the close-up being, that's obviously, the close-up is completely different from stage acting, and being able to switch between the two mediums.
Yeah.
Is it safe to say it is about what you were talking about earlier about subtlety and about what can be telegraphed and shown, not show don't tell, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And for
absolutely.
Stage, maybe it's more tell. I don't know. It is oversimplified.
Yeah, and I think I had to sort of relearn all of that again, or just remind myself that I had to project more. I had to tell the story more physically and show my emotions more, you know. So it is a very different way of acting in many ways. I mean, it depends on the theatre. It depends how big the theatre is. And we did that in the Littleton, which is quite a big theatre. But if you're doing a very intimate, if you're working in a very intimate space, then the acting can be a bit more like TV because the audience are right there. And I'd love to experience that, actually, because it's been a while since I've done anything in a very small theatre space. So that would be interesting. I'd like to try that.
Yeah, I mean, what is the goal and what is the future goal? I know that we are amid a pandemic that's put everything on hold, but like, what's your dream next project or dream role?
I don't really have one, to be honest.
Okay, yeah.
I sing, so I love the idea of bringing in my love of singing and music. I would love to do something like that. But I think it's because of what I've learned, you know, is that you just never quite know what's around the corner, and you can make things happen. And I'm definitely looking into that more now, of, you know, finding material that I really like or a character that I've read. And that doesn't necessarily have to be a book, or, you know, you can read something in a paper and think, well, that could be something really interesting. And
that's cool.
So I'm definitely edging a little more into that headspace of like, well, what, you know, who do I want to play? What do I want to play? But without sort of having too much attachment to it.
Right. And like you said, not so much strategy. It's just...
Yeah. Yeah. Because often I feel that things tend to work a little more fluidly, you know. Mm. So we'll see. I want to do a bit more animation, I have to say. I love... Uh-huh. I've done a bit recently and I really enjoy it. I think it's really cool being part of that process when you're in the booth and you can see the little sketches of the characters and they, and you know, you a lot of them go sort of in tandem. Cool. Like they're creating the characters as you're speaking, and, you know, and I think animation is just so cool. I think it's such a brilliant medium. So I'd like to do a bit more of that.
And is it, so there's stage acting, screen acting, and is voiceover acting its own beast?
Yeah, it's so different. You know, you're in your little booth and it's just really fun. I find it really funny, like finding the voice of the characters. So yeah, I definitely like to do a bit more of that.
Because these days the voiceover industry is still going and animation's still doing okay. And on this podcast, we've actually been featuring more voiceover artists or asking for, like, I would love to hear, do you have advice for someone who's looking to get into voiceover, maybe an early career actor? What should they know about getting into the booth and creating a character?
I think getting your showreel together as quickly as you can. So if you've got access to, you know, because nowadays you can do, if you've got a quiet room or you can stick your head in a cupboard with a sheet over you. I think that's what people are doing. That's totally what a lot of my friends are doing now.
Totally.
Doing podcasts in lockdown and voiceovers in lockdown. So if you have access to that, I think you can find, you know, ad examples or things that you can use. I think that's certainly how I did mine years ago. And record, you know, record your own showreel of voice reel. I mean, you know, you can do different accents or different type of adverts, or, you know, I think doing that as soon as you can so that people get to hear the tone and quality of your voice.
That's a great tip. I did, because we're so nerdy about craft stuff and you are so amazing at accents. You mentioned accents. It's related to voiceover. And is it also maybe related to your kind of, you have a musician brain? Are you, do you work with a coach? Like, what is your approach to your impeccable American accent?
I think that's true. I think maybe being musical helps, because, you know, some would say, you know, it's that thing of having an ear for accents, you know, which I always have done since I was little. But I like to have a coach. If it's a new accent, I like to have someone on me all the time. Like I did in Godless and Good Behavior, actually. I had coaches who were wonderful, but now I've gotten, with the American accent, I'm much more used to it. Sometimes I'll do a refresher, like a refresher class.
Re-oiling the wheels.
Re-oiling the wheels, exactly.
Interesting.
But being around, if you're playing in an American show surrounded by American actors and American crew, it goes in quite easily. But I love doing accent. I'm fascinated by dialect, actually, and how an accent is formed and, you know, dependent on the geography of, you know, where they're from. And
absolutely.
I find it fascinating.
Especially for period pieces, especially for something like Godless, where it's set in the middle of nowhere and you don't know when and where it is. And so did you all, especially with accent work, do you work with the other actors, with other co-stars to get on the same page?
Well, actually, Alice, I had a different accent. So mine wasn't so much of the drawl, because she's from Boston. So, you know, what was a Boston accent back then? You know, it was, it was sort of, and we also didn't want her to seem so different from the others, but there was a, there was an idea that she kind of had an influence of where she is now. But we didn't want her to be too much of a, have too much of a draw. I mean, the Southern American is quite easy for Brits, I think. Okay. I think that's the sort of go-to, or the New York accent. Because they're easier sounds to make. But actually the sort of standard American accent, I found the most challenging to begin with. It's my, it makes my accent feel very, very lazy when I do American, because we don't pronounce our R's.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
So we say R. and that actually requires a bit more movement, you know. So
interesting.
I have to make sure I warm up a little bit, especially if you're like turning over at 7 o'clock in the morning and you've just had your coffee and, you know, a few hours sleep. I have to warm up my voice a little bit and the accent to kind of get my mouth around the words, you know.
Because the other thing I was just thinking about in terms of TV, we often, we've often talked about how in TV, you don't want to paint yourself into a corner. You don't necessarily know where it's going to end. And you want your character to go on an arc. And of course, they're going to go on a journey. But the accent is, it has to be static. Your accent, probably most times, is not going to change.
No.
That's why you have to get it. You have to really practice, I guess.
Absolutely. And that's something I really have to work on. So I have to know, I mean, I like to go onto set knowing my lines inside out. Sometimes that changes, you know, if dialogue changes, you've got to kind of be on your, be on your toes, because sometimes it changes, like depending on the job. So again, I tend to try not to over prepare too much of how it's going to be said in case it changes. However, when I'm doing an accent, it is really important for me to know the lines inside out, because then I forget about the accent. I'm not overthinking. I'm not thinking about the accent as I'm acting. It just sort of comes out. I find recording on, you know, on my phone, on my iPhone, just recording my lines. That's how I tend to work, is that I'll record mine and then I record the other characters. And then I pause, I pause between the lines so that the other character says that bit, which I've recorded, and then I say my line and then I play it back to see if I got it right. So it's like learning a song. That's how I've realized is the way I learn lines, is I have to listen to myself back and repeat. You know, it's all about repetition. Cool. And that's the way it goes in for me.
And that's for every job? Do you do that same line memorization
every
technique?
Every job. I have many voice recordings.
I bet.
I mean, and of course, because you can save everything now. My iPhone goes back to like, I mean, it goes as far, this one goes as far back as Good Behavior, season one. So I've got all the scenes recorded.
This has been so great, Michelle. Thank you.
Thank you.
We really are all about like getting an insight into an actor's process. And you really provided that. Can I ask you one last thing in terms of this early career version of yourself? You've talked about you in your 20s and this maybe early career version of you that was going to be a dancer. If you could go back in time and give that person one piece of advice, what would it be?
I would say just be free and don't worry too much. Just enjoy the spontaneity. And the unpredictability of it all.
Right.
I would say.
The lack of control.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
It's difficult to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's easier said than done. Yes.
It is. Of course. Yeah.
Especially these days.
Yeah. That's true. Maybe not the best advice for these days. But I think for any sort of, you know, looking back into your 20s, I think just, you know, there are things that we kind of worried about in our 20s, you know, when you look back.
Totally.
But to enjoy it, I think more than anything, you know, whatever you're doing, enjoy the moment and and embrace what you're actually doing. Don't look too far ahead, you know, because it goes so quickly, this career. You know, you become a family for a few months and then suddenly it's gone.
Sure.
And sometimes I look back and think, oh, I wish I'd have I wish I'd have joined in a bit more. I'd have, you know, enjoyed it more at some times and not overthought things. And yeah, to enjoy it, I think.
That's great advice. That's great advice. Thank you, Michelle. This has been so lovely.
And you. It's been really, really good. Lovely to meet you.
In the Envelope is recorded at Lotus Productions and Hyperbolic Audio in New York City, and Soundbox LA, Mark Grouse Studios, and Buzzies in Los Angeles. Thanks as always to our producer extraordinaire, Jamie Muffet, and to the team at Backstage, Samantha Sherlock, Mark Stinson, Caitlin Watkins, and of course, Casey Howe. Visit Backstage.com, and don't forget, you can subscribe to Backstage by using the code ENVELOPE at checkout for a free trial. That's right, 100% free. For more exclusive content, join us on Facebook and Twitter at In The Envelope, and subscribe, share, and leave a comment. Would you like us to interview next? Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time for another glimpse in the envelope.